Married men commit suicide at a higher rate in our society.
A married man lives his life supporting his wife and children.
When he faces an abuse, we, as a society, are indifferent to him.
He's lying. Men are stronger.
He must have abused her.
He probably deserved it. It's a rare scenario.
A man is severely assaulted by his wife or girlfriend every 14.6 seconds.
When a man is battered by his spouse, there is no shelter which would take him.
The government, which should protect him, will imprison him, even if he's falsely accused by his wife.
He will lose his job, and will be subjected to social shame. Family courts incentivizes his abuser by extorting money from him.
Divorce alienates him from his children, takes away his house and his money. A man who has lost his children, house, and social image receives new help from the same government, which he pays tax to.
All this helplessness leads to drug and alcohol abuse, which also makes him depressed and suicidal. This is a global phenomenon.
Lists of various suicide statistics per year of men, which far exceeds women's rates.
America,
India,
Australia,
Canada,
Lithuania,
Russia,
United Kingdom.
So many men kill themselves every year. What are we doing about it?
Men's rights, rights are human rights.
Interesting point, because it's almost got to the point now whereby masculinity is seen as a negative thing.
Yeah, the strengths of masculinity and manhood, unfortunately, are being used against men at times. Normal masculine strength or their ability to perhaps assert themselves being misconstrued. Attacking fathers, for example. When was it, about a year ago, I went to the beach reading a book, just relaxing, and the peace in the environment was disrupted by a lady in the background that started shrieking, quite a lot of verbal barrage. And I quickly had a glance, and she was actually verbally abusing her husband, and it went on for quite a few minutes. What struck me from that was a couple of things. He actually assertively responded to her. I was quite impressed in his ability to assertively communicate back. And that was particularly important role modelling for their 5-year-old son that was also in the middle observing this verbal barrage. But the other component was her turning around to her son and saying, "Your father's an idiot." And hands down, that's just wrong. So there's this demeaning of the father role in insults like that, for example.
I'm horrified to hear that, and I was horrified
to hear it.
Yeah, but I'm also more horrified reading through all of these notes to discover that abuse against men is a whole lot more common than we think.
It is. Australia really needs to have this conversation. Where women were many decades ago in terms of the silent phenomena of domestic abuse is really where men are at now. I'm not sure if you're aware, our own Australian Bureau of Statistics, there's a statistic in there that 70% of male victims experience assault by a female perpetrator in the home. And that's a higher number than the female victims at 64%. Why aren't we talking about those numbers?
How's a man going to talk about that?
Yeah.
Where's he going to go? Is he going to go to some authority and say, my wife is beating me or something? Well, they're not going to be believed, are they?
Exactly. This is part of the social influences and the social determinants of health that we need to really put onto the table, particularly in looking at a national men's health policy, because of these kind of issues. The kind of abuse a man may experience by a female perpetrator, a woman's not likely to pack a punch the way a male would, for example, but women abusers, unfortunately, may be very good at sugar-coated viper tongues. So there'll be a lot of statements that are hit below the belt.
Like, your dad's an idiot.
Your father's an idiot, or you think you're a man, or you think you're good in bed. Another example in social media that we see quite often, or you might hear quite often and don't bat an eyelid at, are things like on the radio a few weeks ago. this particular radio station had a wife calling in to tell her husband of over 10 years that he doesn't sexually satisfy her, and doing that over radio. Gee. And I just wonder, would the radio have had the husband do that to the wife?
Yes. You raise a very interesting point.
How would we react to that? And yet we sort of go, ha ha, that's funny. Well, and yet, is it really? Mm. You're hitting men at an important part of their identity. Quite literally and metaphorically, you're hitting them below the belt.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's very insulting to men.
We see it in the media often as well, don't we?
We see many images that we don't bat out an eyelid very much. So, yeah, away from the domestic front, we've got quite a few images, whether it be in video clips or commercials, that we kind of look at and go, oh, yeah. But if we were to reverse them, I wonder if we'd feel the same. So there's some examples we can look at here.
This is a pink film clip. Now, she's being particularly aggressive towards this guy here.
Absolutely. Mm. Well, Pink's a great performer and she's got an awesome personality. I just want to hug her. It's just, we have a look at images like that. And
if that was reversed, we would be outraged.
It's totally acceptable. We don't question that.
There would be an uproar. Yeah. But that's kind of entertainment that we're having a look at there and going, hang on a minute, that's actually inappropriate and unacceptable behaviour. And we're airing it. So that's an example there. That role modelling to young girls or young boys is quite frightening. And when you have a look at Canadian research where they're looking at adolescent girls and adolescent boys and partner aggression, about 34% of the young girls admitted to hitting, biting and scratching their partner compared to 2.6% of the boys. And I think it was 18% of the girls used a weapon against their partner compared to 0% of the boys using a weapon against their partner. That research also showed that young girls observing their mother being aggressive toward their partner, the young girls would also significantly report being aggressive. And so that kind of role modelling, we're missing the point. So there's a couple of other examples we can look at.
Yeah, it's about respect, isn't it, Elizabeth?
Basic civility and courtesy amongst people.
You know, and that whole concept of fighting fairly and not reducing a fight to personalised name calling.
It's really learning how to fight back fairly. That lady I mentioned earlier at the beach, she quite professionally speaking needed anger management training. Mm. And so it's the ability to be able to treat people to fight back, teach people to fight back fairly. That's what I teach a lot of men, in being able to learn assertive communication skills. And I'm glad to say women also coming to seek help to go, I don't want to behave that way. Mm. I know I can feel my viper tongue coming out, but I pull back. But how do I express my frustration? And that's absolutely brilliant, that people want to learn how to fight back fairly.
Let's take a look at another example of this concern in the media. This is a fairly common, I think it's a transport accident commercial?
About speeding, a transport accident, that's right. Now, we have a look at this. Now, it's making a point about speeding, obviously, but here they're making an issue about the size of his penis, obviously, and equating speed with his masculinity and insulting him. Now, I'm not particularly seeing any ads about speeding females and the size of their breasts and any connection to their brain, for example, which we could come up with some pretty crude
images. You can imagine if there was a blonde woman driving the car and the blokes, you know, looked at her and did
and
that.
Sort of going,
we would be offended.
Or what's going on? Yeah. Like, are your brains in your breasts or something?
It
I even
happen.
Cringe at saying it, but we would not put up with it.
It
wouldn't be on the drawing board.
It
wouldn't be on the drawing board.
Yeah,
and yet it gets to this point in these particular commercials and we're looking at it going, ha ha, you go, hang on a minute, that is inappropriate. An unacceptable behaviour between people, and yet men are really being oppressed by it and we're accepting it more toward men, whereas we would have an uproar toward women. It's really demeaning and it's not role modelling.
So emotionally, how are men responding to this? I mean, what's the impact?
Men have actually, unfortunately, they're aware of it, but there's psychologically speaking, they've like developed a learned helplessness in a sense, where it's just like, even if I do say something, I won't be taken seriously, or I'll be insulted, or I'll cop retaliation, or I'll cop the silent treatment. And as you were mentioning before, where do I go? Because when I report it or I want to make a report, I'm either laughed at or, come on, you're a bloke, be tough.
Yeah,
or
deal with it.
You mean she hits you?
Absolutely.
Nah, that's not
What's
possible.
Wrong with it? Yeah.
What's wrong with you? It's as though, and men are even experiencing that I'm less of a man because of it, feeling quite shameful about it.
Because they're copping it.
But the thing with abuse toward men is that the abuse, verbal abuse, emotional manipulation, sexual manipulation, or using children as negotiating tools, they are forms of abuse that are hard to detect and they're hard to defend against. So it tends to seep under the skin psychologically that someone ends up a little battered, so to speak, or helpless, doesn't know how to fight back, and in the end gets so frustrated that they're just trying to cope and maintain an identity.
So just wrapping this up, so the Men's and Fathers Health Summit in Canberra has now recommended a mandatory review of all legislation. How significant is that move?
That is a very important recommendation that they've made. A lot of us were really pushing for an Office for Men status. Now, they didn't recommend for that, which I fully support that they didn't, given that there could be risk of mismanagement with that. But the mandatory review of legislation and policy for its impact on men, for the reasons we've just discussed, are paramount, both on government policy level, domestic abuse front, and day-to-day level with some of the examples we've spoken about, because we're letting it slide and not stopping to question, saying, hang on a minute, if we had a man doing that to a woman and we showed that publicly, we would not accept it. Why are we accepting it for men? Why are we not questioning these things and having just as much of an uproar? They're important social determinants and social influences that are impacting on men's health, physically, psychologically, family and social-wise.
Tell you what, it's pretty shocking, isn't it? And that, of course, in no way takes away from abuse against women, but it's about recognising that it also happens with men. Right.
Yeah. There's an important point to make here on that one in particular, is that there's the automatic assumption that it's an us versus them, that if we're defending and helping out men in this, that it means we're taking away from women. That
and
is
not.
So not the case. It's about it being unacceptable and inappropriate, and we need to look at these images now and go, hang on a minute,
that's not right.
That's inappropriate.
Elizabeth, it's really good to talk to you.
Always good to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
I want to move on to something we talk a lot on the show about, domestic violence. In this next viral video, a hidden camera experiment in the UK revealed some shocking reactions to domestic violence on the street.
What?
To f*** up.
Come here. Get your hand off me.
Come here.
Get your hand off me.
Who was there?
Get your hand off
me. Who was there? Tell me who was there.
People are looking at us. People are looking at us. Will you get your hand off me? Stop that. People are looking at us. What's wrong with you? Thanks. Okay, because someone will call the police if you carry on doing that to someone.
Okay.
Because if I don't, someone else will. You haven't listened. You haven't gotten into what I've been saying to you. You're not even listening to me, that's what. Why do I push you like that? Because you won't stand to me, but you won't listen to me. The I don't have family.
I wasn't.
No, you can't be. No, you can't be. Don't try and walk away. Stop. Listen to me when I'm talking. Don't try and walk away from me. Stop it. Wow.
So we showed you that because people were actually laughing when the girl was hitting the guy. Yet people were willing to intervene when the woman was the victim. 40% of domestic violence victims are men. And I think this highlights something we often don't think about, which is domestic violence can affect anyone.
Yeah, you know, I think what's interesting about this social experiment is you can almost be tempted to fall into the line of thinking when you watch the woman attacking the man, well, what are the chances that she could really hurt him? That is not the point. The point is not physical size, physical strength, the fact that it's probably more likely for a man physically to overpower or injure a woman. The point is abuse and violence. And it can be physical, it could be emotional, it could be psychological, it could be financial. And it does not discriminate. As you said, it affects men also. And I think, you know, you mentioned as we were watching it, it's always the women who stick up for the woman. Mm-hmm. But who stuck up for that guy? No one.
Nobody. Well, and I think it gets back to something we talked about on the show. You know, we've come a long way. And even just the last year with all the awareness that was raised on these really highly publicized cases of domestic violence. But I think there's always been a bit of a tendency to say, well, it's got to be her fault if the woman is the victim. And now I think you see the laughing there. It's, well, I'm sure he deserved it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the danger with domestic violence is if we don't get to a point where, look, if you're being abused, no matter who you are, just to be like, oh, I'm sure they deserved it. That's where I think the laughing comes from.
But at the end of the day, we have to understand that any type of violent motion or movement to another person, it is terrible. And it's against the law. And it's considered abuse. And if anyone you know is suffering from this type of thing, you really should do your part in trying to intervene.
The one thing about that video that I took away is early intervention. If you yes. do see something like this occurring, the earlier you intervene before it gets to true violence where maybe there's weapons involved, and that's you intervene and you do what that woman said, which is, I'm going to call the cops. And that will defuse the situation really, really quickly mm-hmm. in many cases. Now, if you are watching and you are someone in your life is the victim of domestic violence, there is a lot of help available. You can find resources and information at When Georgia Smiled, the Robin McGraw Revelation Foundation at whengeorgiasmiled.org.
Well, now there are millions of parents and grandparents in this country who may be reluctant to show their children affection in public for fear they'll be labelled a dirty old man. Some of these innocent men have been questioned, even detained by police while going about their parental duties. As James Thomas reports, it highlights a growing trend where all men are considered potential predators.
A lady takes photos by the kids' pool. No one bats an eyelid. She's harmless. But what happens when a man does the same thing?
We had a report that someone fitting your description was taking photos of kids up here.
It's this whole thing that men are guilty until they're proven innocent, and that's really wrong.
An airline passenger is asked to move from children on a plane. He's done nothing wrong, except he's a man.
And I said to her, isn't that discrimination?
On planes, in classrooms, by pools, men are being typecast in a role no one wants to be known for.
Not every guy in society is a pedophile, and to be viewed that way is a massive injustice.
On a flight to Sydney, passenger John McGurr says that Virgin Airlines treated him like a sexual predator.
A stewardess came up and she said, I'm going to have to ask you to move. I said, why? And she goes, because you're not allowed to sit next to children because you're a male.
It's a bit sexist, isn't it?
It's just our policy to not have males sitting next to unaccompanied minors.
And she walked up the aisle trying to find a female to ask to swap with me. By that time, people had looked around. And
yeah, how did it make you feel?
Like I'd done something wrong, defenceless as well.
On the face of it, the policy certainly does seem to be discriminatory. It's aimed particularly and only at men.
Barrister David Galbally.
I think the Sex Discrimination Commissioner should act on this immediately and shouldn't let it continue.
Virgin declined an on-camera interview. In a statement, they say their policy is based on customer feedback and is common to many airlines. However, in light of the John McGurr complaint, Virgin are in the process of finalising a new policy, pending the outcome of a formal risk assessment.
One solution basically is to keep the seat free, so males or females can't sit there, but the reason that Virgin don't do that is because it's a seat they can't sell.
In view of the statistics, John sees Virgin's policy as illogical.
A lot of the time the male perpetrators are known to the child.
According to the Australian Bureau of Statistics, 30.2% of child sex abuse is perpetrated by a male relative. The least likely is a stranger at 11.1%.
So basically, a Virgin would have to say to any father or uncle, I'm sorry, you're not allowed to sit next to your child.
The suspicion that because I'm a male, I'm actually, their child is at some risk offends me.
Steve Badger runs one of the country's most successful swim schools. He fears that political correctness is scaring men out of his industry.
One of the kids that I had encouraged to become a swimming teacher said to me this morning that he's actually given up on becoming a swimming teacher because he didn't want an occupation where he felt like he was under constant scrutiny about the way that he was handling himself with children.
The governing authority, AustSwim, now trains teachers to ask permission every time a child in a class needs to be held or touched.
I have yet to be convinced that any of these measures have actually ended up in protecting one extra child.
Just on beat one.
And in the classroom, male teachers are becoming an endangered species.
There's nothing more important than educating the next generation, and we should have our brightest and best, both men and women, doing that work.
Norm Hart is the president of the Australian Primary Principals Association.
It is the fear of litigation, of being judged, of having people think that you have ulterior motives for the work that you do, that makes people, or particularly young men, say, well, that is not the profession for me. I'll think about doing something else instead.
The consequences of the idea that all men are predators is so damaging.
Dr. Karen Brooks is a professor of cultural studies. She believes that society risks alienating men on a wide scale.
Gender discrimination against men in our society does exist, and we see it in multiple forms.
Now, back to those actors we hired to take photos by the children's pool at the beach. The woman loitered for close to half an hour without any interruption. It was a different story with our male actor. First, a protest from a beachgoer. And then some polite questions.
So you wouldn't have any problem with me checking your shots here?
No, not at all.
Of course, there were no photos because it was all a stunt to make a point.
What a terrible thing to do to our young men, you know, to do to our brothers, our nephews, our husbands, our lovers, you know, dreadful. Let's stop it.
James Thomas reporting there.